I, from the very beginning, try to look at as our weakening, still not sure that we are witnessing revolutions, and I don't really see the spring as a reality in the region, even though, you know, my intellectual positioning was to be cautiously optimistic from the very beginning, and saying that there are some questions that we have to address, and one of the questions is the one that we are addressing today about the democratization process in the Middle East, and in which we have to deal with it. People can make it, that it's possible to change the situation, that the status quo that we had for in the region for more than almost two generations, now we can see that things are moving. Not sure that they are moving in the right direction, not sure that we are reaching a stage where beyond the unstable situations in many countries, we are reaching something, but at least there is this mindset, this feeling, this understanding that people can shake the authority of dictators and they can make it. And I think that this is very important. This is an achievement per se, even though the result, and as you know, anything which has to do with uprisings, with very sudden transformations, means that we need time, and it takes time. So to judge the situation too quickly, it's not fair with history. But not to be critical is not fair with human beings and with principles, because I think that we have to be critical with what is happening now. The most important thing is to understand that these were people coming from all the backgrounds, young and not so young, but at the beginning they were mainly young people, bloggers, cyber dissidents, and then people in the street taking into the streets and asking mainly three things. The first is respect for their dignity, second was freedom, and then of course to get rid of the dictator and the corruption within the system. And it's important to get this right. It's about dictatorship, it's about corruption, it's about dignity, and it's about justice. They were not talking about the Islamic reference first. They were not talking about us being Coptic or Muslims, for example, in Egypt. It's us being Egyptians against the dictator. What is important to remember now is that the movement didn't start with them. This was not an Islamist uprising. The first massive demonstrations were quite clear about what they didn't want. They were not clear about what they wanted. So it was quite clear that they were against the dictator. But for what? What after the dictator? To say justice, dignity, freedom, democracy doesn't mean anything if you are not structured at the grassroots level. It's just these could be words and they can be instrumentalized. So the organizations that took over quite quickly were the more organized, having two things, structures and infrastructures and institutions on the ground, and something which has to do with historical legitimacy as to people having opposed the dictators. This was a unity against. Now, to build the country, it's much more difficult than to resist the dictator. It's to the future, the proposal. It's the democratic process that we are talking about. But we should also be clear that anyone who is looking at what is happening in the Middle East only from a political viewpoint and not adding to the discussion the economic challenges is not seriously tackling the situation of democracy. You can't have a true democratization process if you don't get the right economic questions and answers as to social justice. A democratic system without something which has to do with how do we deal with economy, how do we deal with social justice, how do we deal with the poor, how do we deal with discrimination, it's not a fair questioning. So this kind of segregating the political discussion and saying the whole future of Egypt is about democratic or not democratic, the nature of the state, secular or not secular, and not tackling the issue of social justice, economic stability, and the power of the economic forces within, it's, I think, a misleading discussion. And we can see it now. the more the society is fragile and fragilized from within, the more you will have sectarianism and divisions and power struggle from within. So this is where, for example, you can see that the Turkish example, dealing with a secular system with Islamic reference, is less challenged from within because there is an economic success and economic stability. And we need to get this right, because this could be the way of divisions from within. When we speak about Islamism, it's not a monolithic reality. Islamism is as complex as Islam. And when you talk about Islam, you don't have one type of Muslim. We have many Muslim interpretations and many Islamist interpretations. So the Salafi in Egypt are not the same as the Muslim Brothers in Egypt, as they are not the same as the jihadi trends or the takfiri trends, who are still working on the ground. So we need to be careful when we talk about Islamism and not to come with a very essentialized way of dealing with political Islam. That's not right. It's not scientific. It could work when you deal with populism to spread around fear, but when we deal with actors and political actors, and you are truly a Democrat means that at least you need to understand the nuances between the political forces. In a democracy, a true democracy, there are nuances that are important to get, and especially when it comes to the Islamist trend. All what we got over the last 2 years is in fact something that is just gathering all the challenges, all the discussions that we had over 50 years in Muslim majority countries and within the Islamists and among also the secularists. Because, you know, it's not because you are secularist that you are by definition egalitarian as to the way and the way you perceive your role within the state. I think that this perception that it's enough to be a secularist, to be an egalitarian, that all the minorities are going to be treated the same, that's wrong. You sometimes could advocate secularism and advocate also specific rights for specific people. And sometimes understanding that the secular reference is not neutrality towards religions, but against religions. And the Muslim majority countries are not exempt from these trends, that some are thinking still that what we need is to follow in the footsteps of some trends in the West and advocating a secularism which is not the neutrality of the state, but the disappearance of religious reference. You know, when I was talking to Egyptian activists, and I was telling them, it's so sad. It's so sad to see that at the end, all these massive demonstrations for the name of dignity and freedom ends up into something which is the polarization between the secularist and the Islamist. And you are, it's a power struggle. You are not serving the country, you are trying to serve your power. And they are saying, no, this is the West. It's coming from the West. I'm sorry. It's not coming from the West. It's coming from you. You are playing that game. And we end up having a discussion which has nothing to do with the principles of democracy, but a power struggle. And you can see the Islamists saying to the secularists, you are token Egyptians, and in fact, you are completely under the authority or the ideological authority of the West. You are coming and telling us progressive, we are the guardian of religions, and you are, in fact, colonized. And on the other side, we see the secularists saying to the Islamists, you are backward, you are religiously driven, you are not helping us, you are not progressive. So we are between two trends that are struggling, in fact, in the name of authority, and they are not talking about true democratization, they are talking about who will get power. And at the end, we are stuck into a discussion which is not tackling the real dimensions of a democratic process.